Kier Group, the property, residential, construction and services business, had a strong start to trade today after it reported better than forecast first half numbers, with revenue up 32% at £2.1 billion and underlying pre-tax profits up 19% for the first half to £44.2 million. Hayden Mercell is the chief executive and he joins us now, direct from the London Stock Exchange. Good morning to you. First of all, what's behind this performance?
I think it's a good contribution from all divisions across the business. We're blessed, actually. We have a very diverse portfolio of businesses, and all of them have contributed well to the group. Particularly, I think, if I just pick out a couple, our UK building business is really growing quite markedly at the moment in an environment that is, one, growing from a general market perspective, but also a reduced competition. And also our residential business, which is benefiting from the government support, and also, of course, the supply-demand imbalance in the UK. So yeah, very, very pleased with the results this morning.
There's a lot of pessimism circling the property, especially the residential property market at the moment. Are you feeling any of this?
No, I think we're a relatively modest private house builder. We have a very relatively modest land bank. Our real focus is the growth in the affordable housing sector, and we have a real strong set of relationships with local authorities right across the UK. And of course, they are under immense financial pressure. So the ability for them to utilise their land assets to develop housing in conjunction with us is where I see the real growth for our business, and therefore obviously addressing the gap between demand and supply in the UK.
I think I'm right in saying, aren't I, the spreader business, this that you're talking of just now, is I think by far and away the smallest part of your business, isn't it? The big infrastructure spend, the big civil engineering projects is where you major, I believe. Do you see a more balanced outlook for the business as you build up the property and the residential parts of Kier Group?
Yes, well, our business is really four legs, as you rightly say. Property and residential are slightly smaller at the moment, but they are the capital-intensive parts of the group. If you look at construction and support services, both are doing very well. In construction, it's underpinned currently in a growth context by UK building, but as we saw in yesterday's budget, the infrastructure agenda is very much upon us, and I see that as being positive over the medium term. These contracts do take some while to come to fruition. And in support services, we have the benefit of very long-term visibility on our contracts. So we can see arrangements with clients over the next 5 to 10 years. Again, provides really good stability to the group. And all of those factors allow me, quite in a relatively luxurious sense, able to blend that portfolio to best suit the market conditions that we see ahead of us in the short and the medium term.
What would explain those market conditions? I mean, you mentioned you're on target for the second half, whatever that means, but what are the market conditions that are prevailing at the moment? Do you now become to rely more on government handouts? As you said, the Chancellor issuing money for big infrastructure spend driven by government. Are you worried that this is a government initiative rather than a private initiative?
Well, our group is about 50-50 from a public-private sector mix, so we're not biased in any one particular direction. I think the fact that government is pledging its support behind infrastructure is very positive. I do, though, think that the collaboration required between public sector and private sector is going to be something that we see in the future, simply as the private sector has the skills and sometimes the balance sheet and funding available to assist the public sector to bring some of these big projects to fruition.
When do you see some of those announcements that the Chancellor's made recently, and indeed the budget as well, when do you see them coming to fruition, as you call it? How long does it take for these actually to come into real orders?
Well, for us, it comes at different stages. We have a consulting division at the very front end, if you like, of this life cycle. And we are dealing with lots of the, for example, the Northern Powerhouse projects at the moment in a consulting feasibility study sense. So we can already see some of those, and they are already hitting gently at a very early stage some of our revenue figures. Of course, the big construction operations and activities will follow some years to come, but because we have that line of sight, we do get a nice comfort around the fact that these projects are real and they will come, as I said, to fruition over the medium term.
Well, let's take a look at your order book, the pipeline. I think at last count it was about £9 billion, is that right?
That's right.
Pipeline. What can you tell us a little bit more about that? What's going to come out the end? What do you see as being the, you know, some of the profitable businesses that will be able to benefit investors?
So the £9 billion breaks down as £3.5 billion in construction and £5.5 billion in services. So the construction it comprises that building and infrastructure construction activities, and that generally has a look-ahead period of between 2 and 3 years. So reasonably short, but that's the nature of that particular business. the support services business at 5.5 billion, we can see out over the next 10 years. So, for example, I can see already that our revenue at current levels in 2020, we are already 50% secured. We can already see 50% of our work based on the current contracts just running off over the long term. And that is that stability that means we're able to invest and grow the group, knowing we have that underpin, if you like, to that workload. Do you see, we are secured. Sorry,
I was going to say, do you see that growth occurring outside the UK? I know you major in the UK, but I believe you do have interest in some projects outside of Britain. Is that right?
That's right, yes. 10% of our group is overseas. We have three international operations, but the hub of it very much is the Middle East. We operate in Dubai, Abu Dhabi and Saudi Arabia, predominantly Dubai probably if I look at those three territories.
And do you want to grow that, or are you happy with that spread at the moment and staying majorly within the UK?
I'm very happy with our UK business, but I do think there is benefit in having an international operation. It provides an activity set that operates in a different cycle to the UK, and therefore you have a hedging benefit by having those operations. The Middle East at the moment is actually reasonably buoyant. Of course, it has been tempered by the low oil price. But the government is supporting British construction, particularly in the Middle East, through something called UK Export Finance. And that's a real differentiator for us and allowing us to win some really good quality work in Dubai and in Abu Dhabi.
What about that low oil price? What effect does it have on the main core of your business? Are you a major oil user? Do you have much cost that you can take out because of this drop in oil?
Well, actually, it's a bit of a double-edged sword for us, and therefore is manageable because of that. On the one hand, of course, we spend about £35 million a year on diesel, so that cost has come down. And actually, having low oil prices generally drives consumer spending and consumer confidence. So people running businesses will feel more confident if they're able to have lower input costs, and therefore will look for a new commercial building. And of course, that then plays into our construction activities. That's all positive. On the other side, we do have some contracts where we are exposed to commodity pricing. And as a consequence of the low oil prices, there's a strong correlation between that and the commodity recyclate prices. So I have the beauty, if you like, of a bit of a double-edged sword there, but they're all manageable in the context of a group of our size.
Yeah. One final question really has to be all about the EU and the UK. Now, you've not mentioned the EU. You talk about your overseas business being predominantly in the Middle East. The Brexit vote came up on the 23rd of June. Does it make a difference to Kier Group?
I think for us as a group, because as we've discussed already, we are very much looking at the sort of medium and long-term time horizons, stability is paramount. For us to be able to invest in apprentices and graduates and staff, we need to have that visibility of pipeline. So anything that creates instability and therefore uncertainty generally creates delays in decision-making. And that delay in decision-making is negative for us. So I think keeping things in a status quo sense is more beneficial to Kier than not.
Okay. Any headlines we should watch out for in the second half?
No, we're very much on track. Our year end is June, so here I am talking to you in March. I'm very confident of hitting our figures at the end of June. And our dividend increase today of 12%, I think, reflects that confidence, not just me, but the whole board.
Is that a strategy you hope to continue into the full year, that sort of dividend rise?
Yes, we've committed to the market as part of our five-year strategy that the profits will grow by more than 10% every year on year, between now and 2020. And therefore, our dividend will follow that trajectory. And that will be the same for this year as well as the future years between now and that date.
Okay, look, it's been a pleasure to talk to you. Thanks indeed for your time.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
That's Hayden Mosel. He's the Chief Executive of Kier Group.